So thank you very much for the introduction. And of course, thank you very much for you coming that early here for the first talk this morning. And I hope that you will enjoy not regretting getting up so early. I want to introduce myself shortly. I'm an architect. The project that I'm going to present here is not an archaeological research project, although I would say it is research, action research, I call it, in the context of international technical assistance, financed, co-financed by our German foreign ministry, co-financed by UNESCO, also co-financed by Japan, in the context of setting up management and systems for the newly established World Heritage sites in Afghanistan. And I quite optimistically put both of them into the talk, and I hope I can manage this in the time that we have. It is about the site of Bamiyan and Jam. Okay, doesn't work. Sorry, so. And located, both of them, in the central part of Afghanistan, Bamiyan quite in the middle, and Jam a little bit further into the west, an area where you cannot go, unfortunately. In the beginning it was possible, but nowadays it's completely contested area. You only can go with helicopter and military assistance. Bamiyan is quite nice, in fact. That is the cultural landscape you see there. It's an environment, a semi-arid environment, where cultivation, basically, is the one thing that makes this area livable. You see the desert mountains in the background, and in the background here of the picture, unfortunately, I guess the point is here. Here you see the thing that made Bamiyan famous. Unfortunately, also famous for the destruction in 2001, maybe most of you will remember, introducing, unfortunately, that was a little bit fast, the events of September 11. Started in Bamiyan with a plot from Al-Qaeda to blow up the Bamiyan Buddhas in the back and having the Taliban implementing it. Oh, it's going a little bit fast. Before, after, the giant Buddhas, it was two of them, a big one and a small one, so-called big one and so-called small one. The one was 55 meters, the big one, and the small one there in the back. Hey, it's a little bit fast. Sorry. Here. In some distance, that was the second one. So two giant Buddha figures, which were both blown up by the Taliban. The small one, the earlier one, the second, middle of the 6th century, and then the other one a little bit later. The project basically is about what to do with the remains, and we have been, or I have been working there in the context of the salvation of these fragments, in the context of what to do with them. Other colleagues are working, the Japanese colleagues on the mural paintings, colleagues from Munich on the analysis of the binding material and the pigments. So there's a lot of research, conservation research going on, but Bamiyan was inscribed as a cultural landscape not only because of these figures, because there are a lot of other historic remains of importance. One of them is the city of Shari-ul-Ghula, a medieval Islamic city which was destroyed by Genghis Khan on his raid towards these areas. Well, what is a cultural landscape? According to UNESCO, it's the combined works of nature and man. It is the expression of the influence of the physical constraints from the natural environment reflected in the specific techniques of sustainable land use in this case, but it is also the expression of how people spiritually deal with this land. Here it is reflected with this type of shrines, which in the most cases that we know from the very limited archaeological research that has taken place, in the most cases is done on top of previous Buddhist relics. Bamiyan was a Buddhist center in the 6th and 7th centuries, so the Islamic shrines of the Shia community, which have a kind of, let's say, belief in some kind of saints, they are mostly built on top of the previous Buddhist remains, and this in a country of Afghanistan. So you have a kind of Islamic culture on top of a previous Buddhist culture. Buddhism doesn't exist in Afghanistan anymore since the turn of the century, 1,000 years ago. this direction. So our starting point was that the initial nomination map for the World Heritage Site had this quality. Barely showing the site, the cultural landmark, the inscribed World Heritage, is basically a set and a serial nomination of individual historical areas. And what the title indicates, cultural landscape, unfortunately, if you look to these very small pieces here, they are not even included. And that was a problem in the beginning, since the administration at that time avoided to include cultural landscape, which is privately owned land, into the nomination, because they said we cannot interfere with private people. But basically, that is what the value of this landscape is about, the cultural landscape, not reflected in any type of management instrument. So the starting point in the beginning was, The starting point was to map the landscape, the techniques you know, we went through field survey, trying to identify historical areas, very limited kind of old-fashioned excavation by Professor Tarsi, the previous director of antiquities of Afghanistan, now professor in Strasbourg. But quite vast georadar was implemented on the ground in the beginning, in 2004-2005, when the situation was quite stable. We had a quick satellite imagery, identifying a vast area of archaeological area that had to be included into kind of protection maps, which we proposed at that time, quite early. You see here the system that we introduced. That is only the inscribed World Heritage Area, but we identified archaeological remains covered all around in the earth and the traditional settlements, and this is the cultural landscape, in fact. You see it here. So it's a quite vast area, and we at that time already proposed that if you want to have development in this area, you have to take care for the landscape. So we tried to introduce a kind of planning scheme reflected in this map. A few years later, we said, now it comes to the topic, in fact. These maps, these quick maps, they had no topographic information, very limited topographic information. And in order to improve the quality of the maps, we went into satellite imagery, stereo satellite imagery. So we started with purchasing GeoEye satellite imagery, three scenes, each of them, each stereo pair, 3 gigabyte. Pixel resolution, 50 centimeter on the ground, and it was necessary now to have, of course, to bind them all together. So a field survey was necessary and to bind all these scenes together. And luckily we had a wonderful team of Afghan engineers trained by the American military. We took the task in 2 weeks to identify the points that we from Aachen identified solely on the map, that they went into the field to identify these points, install benchmarks on the ground where possible, in order to return to us the head information that we could elaborate the digital elevation model here. And you see here the analysis. So we have derived almost 3 million points automatically with the software, which heavily visual control afterwards. Of course, you have the limitation of the shadowed areas, and by interpolation, it was possible to generate almost 40 million points and to produce a DEM of 2 meter with a 2 meter cell grid. That is the point density. The green points indicate the radius of 10 meters. You have here more than 10 other points indicating the same height, and the red areas are the ones that are a little bit problematic because of occlusion. So that is the result of, yes, interpolation. The problem of interpolation of course is changing your data. So you have to manually afterwards go through it in order to take out defects coming from interpolation. More than 1,000 points, I think, yes, have been corrected manually. That is the existing result. Now a digital elevation model, spatial resolution 2 meters, a geometrical accuracy of less than 1 meter, compared to a kind of limited topographic survey that was done in 2003, and an optical resolution of 50 centimeters, which is a GeoEye sensor. Compared to what was available before, That was the type of resolution that you can get from freely available data. So this one here is the GTOPO 30. This is the radar data for space shuttle mission. And here, that is the resolution of the map that we could were able to generate within a period of 3 months only. Our indication what kind of maps you can produce out of the available data. So I have to hurry up. So that was the area that we could cover in order to generate topographic maps for the use of local management. It means you have to introduce, of course, the real topography, the reality on the ground, to indicate, to make also to decision makers understandable how densely populated this valley already is, and if they want to talk about more people bringing in, building roads. Some ideas even went into having a kind of Chinese part of the new Silk Road railroad going through Bamiyan. Yes, these ideas have all been discussed in the context of development aid for Afghanistan. So these maps now show quite nicely that, well, you have to look what is available, realistically available, possible on the ground. We put this data, of course, into a GIS system that is with fluctuation being used by the different agencies and luckily international agencies, sometimes also by the Afghan ministries. And the purpose, of course, is long-term monitoring. You see on the left-hand side already the rapid development only in 6 years. And luckily, they followed our advice to install the new town in an area which we identified outside of the cultural landscape in order, well, so otherwise all this development that you see on this image on the right would have taken place quite close to the Buddhas. It has become increasingly difficult to go to Afghanistan. That is part, of course, well, that is a thing that we cannot change. But we are constantly asked to contribute somehow. And the second case with the Minaret of Jam, located in an area where you absolutely cannot go anymore, even for the Afghan people there, it is really dangerous to be there if they be identified as government officials. So we have here a minaret from the 12th century, 60 meters high, one of the tallest remaining brick buildings of the medieval Islamic times. I don't go into details here of this gentleman who established in a few years a kingdom reaching from the areas of western Afghanistan up to Bengal in India. It is a very delicate, interesting building. It has a double staircase, helix staircase, and it is located quite close to the river, which in the course of time has caused kind of intense leaning. You see it here. In 2004, colleagues of us from Aachen went there, had a local topographic survey with total station in order to establish the basis, some kind of map for the World Heritage nomination. And this was our starting point, taking their coordinates, handheld at that time, to establish a new map, because the development pressure, but also conservation needs, you see them here, they are increasing. You have the problem of new constructions, of course, that you somehow want to have to control outside of the archaeological area. You have to think about flood protection, because the river is quite intense and high. You see here the destruction of this foundation out of the 80s, which every 2 or 3 years is destroyed at the junction of the two rivers there. And again, you have a quite, let's say, provisional simple map, which is not very helpful in technical terms to plan whatever type of infrastructure. So that is the official nomination map at our starting point. Luckily, there has been archaeological research in this area by colleagues from Cambridge University and from Australia. Which in only one field season in 2004, when it still was possible to go there, tried to get a better overview about the archaeological situation there, and we took this information and combined them without being there in a new map. the obstacle that we had to overcome, we wanted again to go into a high-resolution GeoEye satellite imagery, but for Jam, it was almost impossible to get there. We waited for 8 months. The reason behind is that the American Army or the American government in general is buying all the satellite imagery which is daily produced over these contested areas, and they decide them well on their will if others can have this image or not. So with the high resolution imagery we waited for 8 months, and when we finally got it, it was in winter time, that the images were too shadowed. There was too much shadow in the images to get them to use them well properly. So we and once we got an image, yes, it was shadowed as expected because it was winter time already. The sun was very deep, standing very deep, and luckily there was one single small cloud in the scene, so that we can cancel the order, and we skipped for Iconos imagery, which has a lower resolution, 1 meter instead of 50 centimeters. And then we acquired an additional worldview, high resolution, not a stereo image, but a single image, in order to generate the topography out of the lower resolution, and then to put the high resolution image on top. So that was the large scene that we acquired. We only needed, I mean, this spot here, but we got a stereo scene of all this area for the same amount of money. It was processed again. You have here on the left hand side the result, the autofocus from 7 kilometers in this direction, 5 in this direction, and here on the right hand side the worldview autophoto generated from the DEM that we generated from this stereo satellite. Oh, I have 5. Sorry. Okay, I run. Again, our validity check. So that was the starting point. We translated this rough, of course, lines with the available information from the archaeology into a new map. A new map that we then only had to control. Well, you see here the world property, the red one is these isolated areas. They don't even match, of course, the reality. And in order to understand it better, I mean, that is the reality. What sense makes it to make a line on a map if on the ground you hardly can identify? And since the procedures with World Heritage, they are even not very easy if you want to make changes to once established maps of this type, we then proposed, okay, at least try to make a modest modification in order to at least have the lines of the mountains as a kind of natural boundary for the buffer zone, and combine at least what it is, so to have a so-called minor boundary modification. Otherwise, the government of Afghanistan would have to apply a completely new procedure. So coming to the conclusion here, we are acting World Heritage Management Framework for World Heritage Sites. It's quite a lot of topics you have to deal with. I only here discussed now the planning part and the mediation part, which is in the times of course. Paradigm shift, cultural property, it's not only more about properties, identifying properties, it's understanding the cultural values, and if you want to conserve the landscape, of course it's not possible, so you have to find ways to understand what is the cultural value behind, to make people convinced that preservation of the environment, of the landscape, is actually of benefit for themselves. I think that is the big challenge of 21st century archaeology, possibly not, but definitely management of archaeology. And I think digital technologies have an extreme power to demonstrate the implications of wrong decisions or to show into the correct decision. So preserving cultural heritage, I think it's part of contribution to transformation processes, not only in countries like Afghanistan, I think also in parts of our world. So we have to go back from, we have to leave the classic site documentation behind us and go for classic site documentation is concentrating on the geometric shape, understanding the landscape as a kind of container. We have to understand what, we have to assess the cultural landscape values, and this is to understand the shaping processes past shaping processes, but also the current shaping processes. And to bring, of course, the people into line with what you have understood as a researcher. So at the moment, this is the most challenging part, because the people, probably they are literate on the bottom of the this one is a selection at the university in Bamiyan. This is a lecture with the people affected by protections that you impose through their world heritage. And of course, they understand. If suddenly you tell them you have a kind of ground that possibly you are not even not allowed to grow your potatoes anymore, and then they ask, that is fine with me if you want to protect archaeology, but please compensate me for the potatoes. And that is exactly the mechanism that a country like Afghanistan is facing at the moment. I would say even impossible to find solutions for that. Not to go into this topic, I found it interesting that we have no session dedicated to conflict archaeology in the proper sense. Of course, we have also challenges to face, even in our environments here. Climate change, we cannot avoid it anymore. And I would like to point your attention, possibly if you are interested into this topic, into these quite recent guidelines of ICOMOS. I'm a member of ICOMOS, so I promote the organization a little bit at this occasion. If you're interested in the topic reconstructions, talking about how to build up contested areas, I think this is a quite nice publication to look into. So, I skip this one. I think I tried to summarize it with a nice gesture from the students in Bamiyan. Students like everywhere, they have visions. Bamiyan is a lucky place at the moment. It is a peaceful place, but the problems, the roads are getting better. The problems are coming closer to Bamiyan also. Until all the years there was no problem. They have a small university, but it is exactly for these people, I think, where these efforts is worth taking, and otherwise, I think we should not, we should be honest. If they want, if I don't want to go there anymore, how to convince them to stay? And I think that is my conclusion now for the session, for my talk here at least. Thank you for your attention, and sorry for going over.